practice. I'm not going to read the biographies because you have a piece of paper that has written them all for you, so that we can have a look at them. So we're going to start with Dr. Shama Dossa, followed by Sabiha Allouche, and then Talah Hassan. And the way that I'm going to proceed with this panel is that after every presentation, we'll have a short kind of, just if anyone has any pressing questions, because we need to finish exactly at 4:30 for the closing session. So after every presentation, we'll open it up to the floor, and then we can also probably have a little bit of time before we have to close off the session. So, yeah? Oh, yes, I will give you the 5 and 1 minute warning.
It's a pretty bright So I'm going to show you how that can be done as an example. And then I'm going to talk more about a project that I was involved in that brings arts-informed research and participatory action research together. So I tend to think in colors. My ideas spread out, visual, animated, three-dimensional, tangible. Emotions linked with sound, smell, and touch. Stimulated senses aroused, I describe what I see and feel as a feminist researcher, academic, activist from the global south, as I engage metaphorically with the core subject of my inquiry, which is empowerment. I see a kite, a patang. Its colors red and yellow dancing in the breeze, swaying back and forth in cloudless evening sky, as if to an invisible tune. It soars, letting the breeze carry. It soars up towards Shams, the setting sun. It dips playfully, beckoning, and then looping and spiraling down against and towards the dust. Full of potential, it soars upwards to the sky, the sound of its fluttering paper audible, enticing me to follow as the wind pushes it higher. I watch it for a while, observing its movements, curious at its behavior, at the game it's playing, back and forth, teasing me to pursue. I feel oddly drawn to it, nostalgia for the freedom of innocent childhood games, a time when I was not so jaded. I reach out and grab the dory, which is the string, but the wind carries it off and I miss. I begin to follow its quickening pace. I chart a course, a mental cartography of pursuit through the obstacles that have struck my path. I climb up stairwells and transverse the distance between rooftops, exhilarated in the freedom of my pursuit and the game of catch. My heart beating, my body alive, I'm almost upon it. I pause to judge the direction of the wind, but it is growing dark, and with my vision impaired and fading light, it is now difficult to see. I seem to have lost sight of it. I'm annoyed. To have come so far and to not be rewarded, how can that be? I feel this selfish urge to possess this object, idea, concept. How can it promise, how can the promise of freedom be so elusive? Where could it go? It must be here, somewhere nearby. I split, survey, my eyes searching. Suddenly I see a glimpse of yellow and red in the distance. My mood changes. I'm elated. I begin my pursuit again. I break into a run as the kite gathers speed. Faster and faster, my arms outstretched towards the sky, towards... As it moves back and forth, its shape appears to change. Its colors become muted, merging in the night sky. There are shadows. My skin prickles. I'm aware of others. Out of the corner of my eye, I see them, hands outstretched. Hear their hearts beating in a similar pursuit, attempting to grab the string, perhaps to possess and to control it. But it's my idea. It embodies me. The shadow people, they're there. Why are they after my kite? Would such intentions be rewarded with blood? I'm losing time and the kite is up in the air against my hand, my legs ache and my fingers crawl. Yet I follow. Over the trees and lakes, mountains and continents, buildings and stairwells, I climb, stumble, fall, continue. Suddenly I see it shudder and I note it is no longer flying with its teasing confidence. A tear appears in the yellow and grows bigger. I watch, conflicted, as it begins to fall towards the ground, the excitement of the chase fading. Yet now that it is my reach, I examine it with my heart's content. This was, after all, what I wanted to get close enough to. To understand it, to feel it, to touch it, to discover its parts, to see what makes it whole. That's why it then lies watching it descend, upsetting itself. The pursuit cannot be over yet. It is too soon. I still want to play. I wonder, is perhaps the exhilaration of the chase more interesting than the object itself? I silently mouth, there is strength and substance left in you yet. Fly some more, don't come down, yet fight. But my words are of no consequence. It wobbles and then makes an undignified descent towards the ground. There is a movement, and I can see figures pounce on my buttock. There is a sound of cheering and a glee, a flash of hands, and then an argument followed by a sickening, gripping sound, crunch, and a whoop of victory, then silence. I move forward tentatively. As if programmed to do so, I begin to mechanically pick up the scattered pieces of paper and string, ideas destroyed and mangled. An artifact crafted by human hands of flimsy paper and string has lost its majestic power to attract. I speak aloud as I examine the bits of bone, blood, and flesh. Loving their remnants, desired object, beloved idea, powerful binding force, ideal of freedom, is this what it has come to? Symbolic interpretations. Pattern and form, turning each piece towards the light, looking at its detailing, trying to understand what attracted me to it. exhibition that I have here. The arts informed research gives you this opportunity to begin to look at and interpret research in a different way. So it, arts informed research in a way of redefining research form and representation and creating new understandings of process, spirit, purpose, subjectivities, emotion, responsiveness, and ethical dimensions are required. So it means that the form and the process both are influenced by the arts. At the same time, what arts-informed research talks about is a co-creation between the audience and the researcher, so that the audience engagement with the research is as important as the product itself. The second part that I want to talk about is cooperative inquiry, which is an arts, which is a form of research that comes from action research. And so what I was looking at is community development workers who engage with the concept of empowerment. And how do we bring those two processes together? So community development workers in the context of Pakistan actually work in many cases in precarious employment, which means that they're on contracts. They usually don't know after 6 months whether they have a job or not. And they usually don't have health insurance. Many of them don't know whether they actually will be fired the next day. So there's no security of tenure as well. And so the idea was to bring together a group to talk about their understanding of empowerment. And so the action research sort of cycles through this process of reflection and action, but I combine arts-informed research and reflection and action together in a group form. So some of the things that that I want to talk about are the process and how process and reciprocity could be, for example, ideas that you could think about. One of the things that is interesting is the idea of indirect recruitment. So for example, in Pakistan, most development projects don't actually ask people if they'd like to participate in the study. It's usually people go into the field and say, oh, you're here, okay, let's sit down and have a focus group discussion. Which is very different from sort of the idea of, you know, putting the idea out there and let people think about it and then come back and talk about it. So for example, over here you see one engagement, which is with one of the participants of the study who decided to participate, and she said that process seems very time consuming to share information and to wait for people to contact you if you're conducting the research. Most people probably do not call you back. But I said, but you did call me back. And there must be something that made you call me back, right? And she said, yes, I was curious. I wanted to know about my experience. You said that I could contribute in some way to the research. And yes, that's something that you could do, right? So another person said, on the other hand, as I reflect back, it was something else. So he's also responding to the call. I appreciate having the choice to decide if I want to be part of the study. We don't give the community that choice, which I now realize is unfair, but none of the researchers we work with have ever talked about this or used this thing. So this is a shift in the way that we're looking at research. Another participant sort of said, we usually go to the field and approach the CPO, a community-based organization, on the day and tell them we need people for a group discussion. When the group gets together, we verbally tell them that, you know, this is the study, this is how you can participate. Nobody usually leaves a session. I guess this is the way we do research. So you know how it is. Spend the least amount of time we can and get the job done and then leave. So these are sort of the shifting in thinking as the process was there. My participants decided that they would like to actually be part of a research course instead of for the time that they were investing in. So that was another example of how we shifted the way the research was done. Some of the ways that we simulated discussions and talked about was through something that we developed, which was a creativity box. And so we used different sort of art materials and poetry to simulate, and we used a theme, which was on the city Karachi. So we used poetry, and we used shells and sand and symbolic sort of ideas to talk about the city and a reflective diary. Then that sort of started the conversation. From there, we moved into the theme, which was empowerment. And we talked about reflexivity, what that means to people. Many of the people, see, in Pakistan, community development workers also serve as field workers for research. But they never get a chance to actually reflect on way that they're collecting information and then how that leads to interpretation. And so this was another opportunity to decolonize. Are we done for time? Okay. So give me just one more second. I'll just finish up here. So this was like, for example, a notebook with key questions that were set up. We went to watch a play together. Many of them had never actually watched it for formal performance. And this was an example of it. We had a day of art making in which we talked about empowerment and how free art making could be done to talk about the issues here. And then we also watched a film and did an analysis of a film. So overall, some of the really interesting findings from this were that although people were in precarious employment and it was challenging for them, many of them decided to stick with the one-year process of the reflection and action. And they also worked in co-creation of art and artifacts, as well as developed lasting connections and collaborations. But at the same time, the issue of precariousness continued in that process, and many people lost their jobs at the same time and decided not to continue with it. So there are challenges to this process, and I'm happy to talk more about it in the question and answer session, but I just wanted to outline the entire process. Thank you.
Thank you. So I'm combining the work of Sara Ahmed with the recommendations of Mikdashi and Buar. My Mikdashi and Jasmine Buar. And basically what this paper, literally, whatever I'm going to speak, proceeds from the idea that I view Muslim sexuality as queer, where queer is akin to Sara Ahmed's stranger fetishism. Yeah? And the stranger is produced not as that which we fail to recognize, but as that which we have already recognized as a stranger. I wish I had written that. Strange fetishism is aware of the Orientalist tropes of protecting the otherness of the other, right? Which obviously duplicates and us-them violence. So this is the larger methodology that drives this paper. However, what I want to look at today, and hopefully successfully relate to the problem, is the importance of turning our gaze inwardly when we think about homophobia. And these are the recommendations that were put by Rahul Rao, his colleague, a native scholar based at SOAS, literally across the world. And basically, when I turn my analysis inwardly to look at the locations of homophobia in Lebanon, and Lebanon is one of those contexts, right, that are reproduced in mainstream media as this amazing oasis of LGBT, you know. So these are the three main points I think I would like to highlight. So one of them is the politics-religion nexus in Lebanon, also known as you know, the alliance between the religious authorities and our member of the parliament. The alien rhetoric of local LGBT activism, although here I should say maybe the sometimes alien rhetoric of local LGBT activism, and really highlight the latest work of, it's not latest, but recent work of Hassan Moussaoui when he talks about fractal or Orientalism, or the idea of Orientalism within the Orient itself. A very quick definition if we're not familiar with the, because, I mean, I'm bound to refer to homonationalism at some point. So it's a concept, theoretical concept, coined by Jasir Pouar, and this is very loosely paraphrased, summarized, slashed, everything. Yeah. So it's really a barometer by which a state's civilizational status is measured against its treatments of its LGBT population, right? So for example, here I'm going to put two photos very quickly. So this was during, right, when ISIS became very, very publicized, blah, blah, blah. This was really the stereotypes to talk, you know, to illustrate how, you know, Middle Eastern societies are so backward and incapable of, you know, appreciating, you know, homo desire, non-normative identities. And these photos of ISIS literally throwing young people off the roof, whether they are, you know, even when they are suspected, right, of homosexuality or not. So, and I want to contrast it with this, right? So Israel, by saying, again, very quickly, I don't know how familiar the backgrounds of the audience, but talking about homonationalism, for example, in the context of Israel, Israel declares itself the only democracy in the region based on its, you know, basically tolerance, right, attitude, including in the law, the inclusion of self-identified gay and lesbians in the army, etc. Yeah, this is so, in homonationalism, in the barometer, Israel scores quite good. Yeah? We treat our LGBT right. But of course, we know that this is on the back, right, of the Palestinian population. So, after this theoretical and methodological clarification, I'm going to begin, you know, with the, related the spaces, right, or the precise locations of homophobia in Lebanon. So, again, if you want to think about Lebanon in terms of, you know, in mainstream political analysis, did it score high or low, you know, on just people worse barometer on of homonationalism? It is a puzzle, right? So on the one hand, if we only want to look at the low, right? No, so it won't score well. We have our article 54, like most post-colonial societies. And but at the same time, you know, we have these spaces, right? Momentary exceptions, let's say, every now and then of, you know, LGBT spaces, activities, spheres coming together. So there's really a puzzle here, right? So how can the law be so homophobic yet, you know, we know that a lot of tourists like save money all year just so that they can go to Lebanon and explore the... So here I wanted to show you, for example, this was an article in the Jerusalem Post. It was just before the uprisings started in the Arab world. And so, like, you know, this image of Lebanon to a point where somebody, what's it, Benjamin Pem, argued that both Beirut and Tel Aviv are competing for pink dollars, right? So, like, yeah. So clearly, I mean, let us start with, you know, the problem of homonationalism. Definitely a very rather, it's an instrumental, it is an instrument basically, right? It's very Eurocentric, but also it's Eurocentric in the way it reflects its formulation of the legal sphere as independent from all other spheres in society, right? So, for example, for many contexts and societies in the global south, oftentimes the penal codes is going to intertwine with further regulatory systems, right? That includes religion, customs, traditions, skin-based patterns of governance, etc. So, and this is why it is important, for example, in the context of Lebanon, to think about homophobia. And I'm borrowing here from a cool African scholar. I'm not sure if he's from Kenya or South Africa. Please, call, I mean, let me know if you know Copano Rapelli. And he does this really wonderful work of distinguishing between vertical and horizontal homophobia. You know, like what does it mean when the law and society do not necessarily come together? You know, in terms of homophobia, for example, in the context of South Africa, he uses the example of correctional rape for lesbian women. Right? So South Africa, for example, is the, we know, right, historically, it's the first country that decriminalized same-sex activity. And even, I think, gay marriage, I think so, yeah, right? And it approved gay marriage among non-normative couples. But at the same time, we know that, you know, society is not necessarily, not basically not everyone sees eye to eye. So again, you know, when you want to think about homonationalism, right, and the way it's used so irresponsibly, like it's so easy for, what's her name, Hillary Clinton, right, to say gay rights are human rights and universal rights. Well, there are a lot of bugs, you know, to include to the conversation. And, you know, focusing on Lebanon, where vertical homophobia is a concern, we have to look at the ambiguity, really, of Article 534. It doesn't matter if you are homosexual, heterosexual, transsexual, transgender, non-normative, all the acronyms you can think of. This article is going to be used against you, right? So it has been used in instances in the law, even when they are devoid of sexual intercourse, but also the article itself was deployed for the non-conviction of same-sex practitioners, right? And how do we explain its applicability to both non-heterosexual and heterosexual contexts? Well, I mean, one way, you know, to think about it is that literally the ambiguity or ambivalence, we can have a discussion, is it ambiguity or is it ambivalence of Article 534, really services Lebanon's political religion nexus. So just to give you an idea, you know, in I think 2007, yeah, January 2017 was the last time a judge in Lebanon acquitted a couple accused of same-sex, of not being against nature, right? He was like, actually sex between two human beings is not against nature because the human organic body is nature. So he refused, okay? And so this is taken from Gay News website, but you will find similar celebratory articles from Amnesty International to wherever, saying, using literally the same terminology, Lebanon moves one step closer to decriminalizing homosexuality. Okay, thank you very much. Let me go back to my analysis. So, and I think here it's important to I really, really like the latest story about Jasmine Pouar and Maya Mikdashi. Basically, they're telling us, what's this obsession all of a sudden with using queer theory, you know, in several Middle Eastern contexts? Yeah, like why? Actually, rather than looking at the Middle East from queer theory, you should really look at it from disability studies perspective, because it's so debilitated by the permanent war of, you know, imperial, blah, blah, blah. You know, like, you know, just because queer theory is in fashion, like everyone wants to have the best article written on homo nationalism, pinkwashing, queer theory in the Middle East. And of course it makes sense, right? And the way they frame it is, it's almost like the whole of the global South is raw data. Literally, raw data waiting to be reified by scholars, usually scholars. Because, yeah, I mean, we should look, right, at the tensions, but also the overlaps of academic work with activist spending. So, And here, to talk a little bit about, you know, the lived reality of self-identified LGBT population in Lebanon. This is based on, I would say it was you know, lots of data that were collected on the site during my PhD fieldwork in Lebanon. So, you know, you speak to them and you ask them, why are you so not interested in mobilizing against Article 534? And usually because they are more concerned, you know, with their kin and friends and sect and piety and faith, etc., right, compared to Article 534. And this is really, it came across the spectrum of the sectarian multicultural diversity that in Lebanon, whether it's from a Muslim, Christian, or I had actually two truth interlocutors. Yeah, we have a big sect in Lebanon with the truth, and I mean, maybe you are informed, maybe you're not, but it's just really to tell the audience, Middle East societies are really heterogeneous. Not everyone is Muslim, and not all Muslims are happy with being Muslims, and there are lots of Christians, and there are lots of other sects as well. So basically, as a result, right, of these tensions between their faith, you know, the Article 54, etc., oftentimes they have really to invest considerable emotional labor, time, and money, right, in order to maintain long-lasting relationships with each other. And not to add, right, the quite masculinist, patriarchal atmosphere you will find in LGBT spaces. Yeah, so a lot of self-identified trans women or lesbians would prefer really to work outside of the very patriarchal or masculinist, let's say, environment they find in. So, well, I mean, I was going to show an embarrassing movie. I don't think I'm going to, you know, be able to show it, but basically the movie, am I going to be able to? No. Anyway, it doesn't matter. Maybe you've seen it a few months ago. A mayor in Brumana decided that it was a very smart idea. And actually the women, right, who were hired, like, let us not annihilate their agency in the discussion. Basically, women wearing very, very short shorts as traffic wardens, yeah? And these are his exact words. people in the West don't visit Lebanon because they think it's a country of Islamic extremism. We want to show that we have the same way of life as the West. You wear shorts and we wear shorts. We have democracy, our women are free. Yeah? So why am I using this example? And this is why everyone should read the piece by Noor and Nof and Aiden. When we cannot think sexuality and, you know, sexual orientation in the Middle East irrespective of gender performativity. Yeah, it doesn't mean if you are a very straight acting self-identified gay man, you're fine. Yeah? If you are a very effeminate man, heterosexual, married with children, it's not okay. So really, 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 the intersection of gender performativity, like Butler told us about it, the reiteration and the repetition of the, you know, we must get the point. Yeah. And the point about the video really shows you how, you know, the conflation of progress and modernity, right, is very shaped by Western aesthetics. And again, if you want to bring it back, that's the last point, to Hassan Moussaoui's idea of Orientalism within Orientalism, right? This celebratory image of Beirut is very neoliberal, it's very founded in consumerist patterns. And we know from antecedents that whenever the Lebanese state want to clamp down, because at some point they have to appease, right, the religious societies, the authorities, it's not the middle class, well connected to the political sectarian leaders who are going to be targeted. It's literally everybody else, especially in this climate, if you are Syrian and Palestinian displaced, forcibly displaced in Lebanon.
Thank you. Thank you, Sabiha, for also clarifying some things around Article 534, which was mentioned in the keynote session this morning. Are there any questions or comments? Is there a YouTube link you can share for the embarrassing community?
Well,
we can search.
It's not a YouTube video. It's included in an article by The Economist, who always get things. Is it The Economist or Telegraph? I can't imagine. But it has an ad before it. But anyway, I mean, you know, like even when, so the good thing about the video is that the journalist actually took the time to interview the women. You know, why are you wearing these shorts? Are you okay with it? Of course they're okay with it. Because we know from critical, you know, from critical examination of the Lebanese state, that every member who holds an official seat somewhere in Lebanon, whether you're the mayor or a civil servant or member of MP, they are an extension of the extended family. Yeah, so the mayor of Rumana is literally a paternal figure to these girls. They are within their community, within their sectarian, you know, safe bubble, and no one is going to harass them. So, of course, like everybody wins. Yeah? Not everybody.
Certainly. So, any questions before we move on to Talah's presentation?
Yeah. I have one, and it might be a little bit long to discuss, but maybe I'm just going to throw this out there. So, just before, and Lasha suggests that we study the Middle East from a disability perspective instead of a peer perspective. So, I was wondering if you could just tell us how to draw that kind of methodology comparison to queer here.
Okay. So I mean we have to put this a bit in context. So Kuwar and Jasbir are both in the Kuwar and Mikdashi are both in the in good girls university in the Center of Women Studies or Gender Studies, I'm not sure what it's called. And really, their work really speak to each other, right? So Mikdashi writes a lot about settler colonialism, pinkwashing, etc. And just give you what she writes about everything, and she's amazing. But basically what they're doing is, you know, so everybody is writing about the Middle East from a queer theory perspective. Okay. But, you know, we know that queer theory emerged from a very specific experience grown up, all these sorts of them. And they're like, can we ever speak about queer theory without, you know, orienting it back, you know, to US scholarship? And that's really, I mean, this is, so in that article, this is really, they're opening up a conversation. They're not saying that they have all the answers to all the questions. But when they put it, you know, when they contrast it with disability studies, it really, really makes sense. You know, like, especially since disability studies in the US is often studied in conjunction, and it really branched out from queer theory, you know? So, yeah. Basically, this is, yeah, this is what they're, how can you speak about it without referring to that? However, they do not negate the importance of the activism written origins, right, of the theory. But I think it really makes sense. And, yeah, what does it mean? And they, like, what kind of queer, like, figure can you, we even contemplate, you know, when you're living in a context of everyday war, literally everyday war, continuum of war, gender war, peace and, you know, like, this stupid myth of peace and war being clear-cut binaries, because they're not.
Thank you very much. What's yours? I think we'll, I guess we'll just go with the presentation and then take questions at the end.
Hi, so I'm Talah, and I'm going to present about the research project that I'm doing with the anti-racism movement in Lebanon. Just quickly to frame it, basically the anti-racism movement is an activist NGO that hosts three migrant community centers in Lebanon, mostly for migrant domestic workers, and we're doing a research project, a feminist participatory action research project with one specific activist, Ethiopian activist group, who sometimes use the migrant community center as a space. And this research project is under the umbrella of GetW, the Global Alliance for Trafficking, Global Alliance Against Trafficking of, or Trafficking, Against Trafficking of Women, which is an NGO based in Thailand. And they wanted to do I'm going to say FPAR instead of Feminist Participatory Action Research every time. So just, yeah, so they wanted to do an FPAR project on safe and fair migration. So how this is located within the anti-racism movement is that we wanted to kind of examine how activism and the state structures that govern migration, and specifically domestic work, and the state crackdown on migrant domestic worker activists, what is their role, how are they both located in the discourse on safe and fair migration. So basically, FPAR is a methodology that, I mean, I think Dr. Shama touched upon it earlier a bit, like action research. Basically, yeah, the methodology takes into account, especially that it's feminist, like FPAR, it takes into account gender and all of its intersections is very central in doing research. And it is participatory in nature, so the ideological idea behind it is that it's that like researchers construct the research project together with participants, or well, ideally co-researchers. On the end, I'll touch a bit about upon the challenges of this and why I don't think it's always like this always works. But yeah, it should be participatory in nature and geared towards action. So the end goal of this kind of research is not to like analyze or see subjects like participants as subjects of analysis, but rather to do research with participants or co-researchers, if you can kind of reach that level of that equilibrium, in order to push forward a form of action. So to jointly produce knowledge together. So I'm gonna talk a bit about like the research questions, and there's so many layers to this, and like I'm gonna try not to jump too much back and forth and to have some coherence, but bear with me. So I'm gonna talk a bit about like the research questions that we have on the general context, which is kind of more in line with the second panel, actually, in terms of like the colonial context of domestic work migration and the structures that govern it. And then I'm going to move on to talking actually about the activism and the FPAR as processes of decolonization, or at least a form of undermining a current system that stems from colonialism and other violent structures. So our research question, so basically migrant domestic work in Lebanon is governed by something called the kafala system. Kafala means sponsorship, so it's just the sponsorship system basically, which means that migrant domestic workers come to Lebanon under one individual sponsor for both their work and their residency, and this person is also their employer. So they work in their house, and this person is also normally it's not necessary that it's this way, but this usually happens, this person is also their host. So my migrant domestic worker will also, especially if she is documented and her papers are in order according to the state, will very often live under the contract in the sponsor slash employer's house. So it also becomes her house, in theory. So some of the research questions that we wanted to tackle was, what are the abuses of the kafala system? As you can imagine, there are very, very many when you have this much ownership over somebody's body and papers and legality and everything. And how is the kafala system in particular silencing activism, especially activism by women migrant domestic workers? How is the kafala system located in a global context? How does it follow global patterns of migration, economic structures, colonialism, neocolonialism, imperialism, etc., etc.? How are activist migrant domestic workers continuing to organize? What are the challenges? What are the successes? What are the community and emotional aspects of their organizing? What are the logistics in terms of registration and legality and all of that? And finally, how can NGOs, such as anti-racism movement, but other NGOs that have programs that work with migrant domestic workers, and other local activists, how can we all sort of not just be in solidarity with, but very actively support this activism, which is also very much intertwined with other movements, but not always consciously so. So the movement of migrant domestic workers is often isolated from women's movements, labor movements, anti-racist movements, like refugee movements, all of these. But in fact, all of these are, of course, very much intertwined. So some of the violations that the kafala system propagates are violations of freedom of movement, freedom of like bodily autonomy, reproductive justice, freedom of employment. For a domestic worker to be able to change employment, she has to have the permission of her current employer, so there's no freedom to quit, basically. Technically, workers also need the permission of their employers, from their employers to leave the house. Although there are some working conditions specified in contracts, such as day off and working hours, these are very easily neglected. Very important, migrant domestic workers are not under the labor law, so this is a very important point. So there's no proper investigations or anything, because domestic work falls outside of the labor law. So these working conditions in the contract are very much up to the discretion of the employer, of the agencies that recruit and whatnot. Sorry, there's a lot of details and I can't go into everything. But you can imagine the levels of violations from labor exploitation, overtime work, to various forms of abuse and assault, to criminalization and detention and deportation in the case of a worker losing her legal status because she leaves employment without permission from her employer and whatnot. And all of this governance is basically justified through global structures and patterns that that come from capitalism that value capital over human rights. Not getting into the problematics of human rights discourse, but just to use it as a general term, over humans, over their rights, over that. So money is under capitalism is the most valuable and cheap labor. So basically, so all of these global structures are kind of lead to this group of people being cheap labor for the state. And all of this is further justified by nation states and citizenship as a way to legitimately deny political power and to legitimately kind of govern a class of people where you can just easily say, oh, well, you don't have citizenship, so you don't have access to state rights, and that's that. And this kind of assumption is taken for granted by states, by NGOs, by many, many different institutes, both of the state and aside from the state. Obviously, this is all also racialized and gendered. Domestic work is already devalued, already feminized, when that intersects with race. There's a whole other level of discrimination and assumptions about bodies and their role going on. And of course, domestic work in the private sphere makes it even more difficult to tackle in terms of questions of bodily autonomy. And in many cases, there's a literal, like workers are literally confined to the house. So not just like in theory that women are confined to the kitchen, but literally people are locked into the house. So this is all very racialized and gendered. And the targeting of activists comes as a result of all of this. So there's, on a legal level, there's no right to register if you're a foreign group that wants to register as an organization. There's no right to unionize. There's no freedom of movement, like I said. And there's no right to collectively bargain or to gather or anything. So this is the legal aspects of targeting activists. In practice, this takes the form of random, stops and searches, if I can use that term in this context, women being stopped by any kind of state authority to check papers, and this is obviously legitimized because they have a residency sponsor. And if people are seen as criminals or are criminalized because of their lack of documentation or their sponsors didn't permit them to go out or whatnot, this can very easily and often lead to detention and deportation. And this, of course, happens a lot in the case of activists, because a lot of activists who can work are people who are not necessarily confined to certain households. They might live on their own, they might not have papers, they might be undocumented. So there's all of these intersections, and so a lot of the time activists are also the ones who are legally targeted because of the logistics of activism. There might also be, I don't know how to explain this, but a lot of activists might also be undocumented because it's easier to organize if you're not confined to this contract, to this household. So just quickly, I just want to talk about how activism is a form of undermining a structure that can be seen as decolonization, especially if you think about the colonial roots of migration and nation states and all of that. And maybe in the discussion we can also talk about how the kafala system in particular does stem from a very colonial history, especially in the Gulf and then leading to Lebanon. So activism is a form of the way I'm seeing it in this project, it is a form of also decolonizing the knowledge that the state, the pre-assigned roles that turns into knowledge about what bodies should be doing what and what positions certain bodies occupy. And activists in their work, in their casework, in their community organizing are kind of redefining these positions that they've been pre-assigned and challenging that, their passive citizenless, whatever positions under the state authority. So in this case, I see activism as a kind of activists as kind of holders of knowledge of how a better state system could be and should be, and both on a theoretical level but also on a practical level. So there's many very solid recommendations that come from activists' work. It's not just, and especially in this case where there isn't necessarily time for research and theory and all of that. In this case, it's very practical demands. Ratify this convention, include us in the labor law, et cetera, et cetera. All of these, if we do take them into the realm of analysis, we can see that they are coming from a place where knowledge, colonial knowledge about roles, women's roles, work, bodies, and freedom, about global relations, about attending to people's needs based on their experiences, how all of this is coming through in the demand. So they, once we think about this in a more decolonial way, we can see that these things are aligned and that this state knowledge is being challenged through activism. So voice itself is challenging the system, the voice itself is being criminalized for challenging the system, and all of this is kind of playing a role in undermining the global structures kind of like doing, using FPAR in tandem with activism. I saw this kind of way in which they can jointly work together to challenge both state knowledge and state power, as well as traditional academic knowledge and power. So on the one hand, we have a chat like through FPAR and giving platform for activists to produce knowledge alongside researchers in an NGO. We're challenging like who, like we're using this NGO state-sanctioned platform, although the state doesn't really like ARM as an NGO, but anyway, we're using this kind of research, like, you know, mainstream accepted platform to give voice to people whose knowledge is usually denied as knowledge. So that's on the state level, and then on the academic level, we're also challenging, of course, this has been touched upon throughout the whole conference today, like notions of academic research and whose voice gets heard in academia, and who's, you know, who is a subject of analysis, who is the producer of that knowledge, who gets the ultimate power over defining the experiences and the voices of the people who need to be heard. So I just kind of felt this joint sort of challenging of both the state and academia was really interesting in this case. So going from subjects, both subjects of the state, subjects like bodies that are owned by the state in a way, legally, as well as subjects of knowledge, subjects like of research in academia, to producers of knowledge in both realms. So both in the state, producers of knowledge of better system, and in academia, producers of knowledge of what is actually going on, rather than us speculating on this group of people as, you know, as subjects of analysis. And just finally, like, I wanted to point to how, like, so often, you know, the infamous Foucault, whatever, knowledge is power, but also, like, I feel like here we also see how power is also knowledge, like, how people or institutes that hold power, that gets normalized into the kind of mainstream knowledge that we hold, how we're supposed to act, what we're supposed to do. Citizenship is taken for granted, borders are taken for granted. So how all of these states and societies are structured, the knowledge around that is normalized because of power. I can just talk for 30 seconds about the challenges. If I have 30 seconds, 10 seconds.
Yeah, very quickly.
Okay, just the challenges of this, like, practically speaking, I don't think it's always ideal to talk about researchers and participants as becoming co-researchers, because you mentioned this as well in your talk, time, logistics. Migrant domestic workers are working like up to 20 hours a day, up to 24 hours a day, and here we are asking them to come and work extra for much less money than what researchers are getting paid, if any money at all, and expecting them to be co-researchers in this. And I find it problematic in its own way. I think ideally it's a beautiful idea, but I feel like there's also a certain role that we can occupy as researchers. We really have to unpack how we do the research, but I mean, I've faced it, like, with participants, you know, they would often tell me, like, but you're the researcher, like, do your job, you know, like, I'm not here to do your job. You have to do the research and then support us. So the idea is that this research will support through action the work that the activist group we're working with is doing. So this is what they want to see in this case, and I thought, well, FPAR doesn't always cater to that because it has this ideal of, like, co-researchers, and, you know, it doesn't really attend to the privileges, actually, that exist in this sphere. And thank you.
Thanks very much. Actually, it's really interesting that you ended on this point, just because it reminds me of something in this book called Participation, the New Tyranny, by Bill Cook and Uma Kathari. I don't know if you've read it, but it says that, you know, participation becomes an act of faith. You know, it's something that we believe in, but we rarely question. And so we have this huge focus on the tools and techniques rather than actually kind of critically interrogating our positions as researchers amongst these communities. So I think that...